So I'm going to say hi to everybody who's joining us on Facebook Live because there are some people who couldn't make it in person. So we're just going to have a soft start here and allow some people to come. But I want to welcome everybody who's joined, and please feel free to say who you are, ask questions. I have a moderator here who will answer any questions that you type in to the Facebook bar there, the comment bar. So, and of course, you guys should ask me any questions that you have as we go on. And I need to start this recording, too. There's so many devices. Okay, there we go. Okay. So, first I'm going to start with just an overview of what we're going to talk about tonight. So, we're going to start by talking about some acute remedies for some very specific complaints that really are for women around pregnancy, nursing, bladder infection, stuff like that. Really acute stuff for you guys to be able to take some information home to help treat yourself, treat your friends, treat your daughters, whoever it might be who are having these issues. The second half of the evening, we're going to be talking about chronic complaints, and it's a little bit different. The reason that my handout has all this acute stuff on it, and then it just says notes, is because these are really issues that you need to get cared for. I don't want you going out and like taking the note, I need sepia, and then going and taking it yourself. Now, why would I not want you to do that? On the one hand, let's say you have migraines and you want to try one of those migraine remedies. Great. It's going to work like an acute probably, and it will be a little bit more difficult for you to assess how is it working for me as a whole individual. So it isn't that there is anything wrong or you're going to hurt yourself or do anything bad, but when you have a chronic complaint, you'll get the best success and the best outcome by having a professional homeopath follow your case once a remedy has been chosen. It's chosen in the same way that we choose the acute remedies. It's just that it's done on this much larger scale. So that's sort of the roadmap of what we're going to talk about. I'm also going to talk about, so I'm going to be talking about thyroid dysfunction, migraines. Hi, it's okay. Come on in. No problem. And if you haven't been here before, or even if you have, you can sign my little sign-in sheet, hi, so that I know who you are and I have your email address. And so I'm going to be talking about specific remedies that are kind of heavy hitters, as my homeopathy teacher would say, for specific complaints. And these are going to be the remedies that are really common for all kinds of women's complaints. All kinds of complaints in general, beyond even the issues that we're going to be talking about tonight. And then I have some cases to read to you, because I think it's one thing for me to read you a description of what sepia is like, but it's quite another thing for me to read you a case that I took where someone got sepia and what the actual result is. So I have some really nice cases for you. They're not too long. Hi, come on in. Yay! Okay, I see more people coming.
Yeah!
Hi! Come on in! So much of the homeopathy that I've taught here has been focused on kids, and I'm so pleased to talk about women because,
yes,
because we need to take care of ourselves and we need to give ourselves some time, some healing time, some healing opportunity. We always come last in the priority, as you know, I'm always talking about with my friends. Everybody else always comes first in the family, especially sick kids. But then, you know, we always end up kind of at the short end of the stick. So I encourage you to take this all in, just let the second half of this flow over you to see if any of it resonates for you. And I hope that it gives you hope and inspiration and a feeling of resolve to help any issues that you might have. Okay, so first we're going to talk about nausea. And this could be any kind of nausea, but right here we're talking about pregnancy nausea. So is anybody here pregnant? Do you all have teenagers? Are you pregnant, Lexi? I'm not pregnant. But, you know, what I love about homeopathy for pregnancy nausea, a.k.a. morning sickness, or it could be all-day sickness and all-night sickness, is that it's so awful. Mm-hmm. It's so awful to feel nauseated all the time. It's so debilitating and horrible. And there are such simple answers and solutions for that. So that's why I prefaced by saying, help yourselves, but also help your friends. If you have a friend who's pregnant, who's having a hard time, tell them about homeopathy. Get them a book. I didn't bring all my homeopathy books. If you've been to my lectures before, you know I was bringing the same books. They just live in my bag. But today I brought all new books. And this is a book I just pulled off of Lindy's shelf. It's one of the home use books. I also like one called Everybody's Guide to Homeopathy. As I've said before, they all have the same kind of information in them. Some are a little bit more in this direction or add a few remedies to them. So anyway, if you know anybody who's sick with morning sickness, please tell them about homeopathy. And I'm going to teach you right now what they need. Okay, first and foremost is sepia. And you're going to hear about sepia all night long. It's going to be, guess what? Blood infection, sepia. Ugh, everything has sepia. So sepia has horrible and constant nausea. There is an empty sensation in the stomach, and you can follow along. This is all right there. It's worse in the morning, worse from motion, and especially worse from odors. This is really the keynote of sepia. I had a patient once who said she could wake up in the morning and smell if someone had opened a packet of chicken in the kitchen, and it made her sick, and she had to throw up. Because that's how sensitive you are. Like, never in your life have you ever been so sensitive, but suddenly now you are. So this is really the keynote for sepia. You could save someone's life with sepia. So, I even wrote it right there. Sensitivity to odors that were previously not bothersome. So food and even one's own husband is just like, ugh, you're so gross. And it really is just this alteration during pregnancy. Nausea from the thought of food, but better from actually eating, which can be hard to eat when you just think this is so disgusting and I want to throw up. Okay, tobaccum is our second one. You know, raise your hand if you wanted to vomit the first time you ever smoked a cigarette. So yeah, it's horrible, right? Deathly nausea. You're pale and clammy. You might even appear green. It's really gross the first time you do that. So tobaccum is made from tobacco. That is the source of the remedy. So this nausea would be aggravated from movement and in the morning before breakfast. So that would mean walking around, or it could mean in the car. Oftentimes car rides can lead to nausea anyway, so that's just aggravated from that. Better from vomiting, which is really an important thing to note when you're treating your friend, since none of you are pregnant right now. Because sometimes there's nausea that is not better from vomiting. Like, no matter how much you vomit, you're still nauseated. I mean, at least there's that, right? At least if you throw up, you feel better, okay? So that is the one good thing. Also, there can be itching all over the body. That would be what we would call a concomitant symptom, something that's going along with the nausea but isn't necessarily directly related to the nausea. Then we have ipecac. Ipecacuanha is the Latin name. As you probably know, ipecac is something that you would drink to make you throw up, so it makes sense that it's a nausea and vomiting remedy. Again, horrible nausea, because I'm not telling you the remedies that just have a little bit of nausea. These are like really bad nausea. A hanging down sensation in the stomach, which only someone who is really having it could tell you about. Unrelieved even temporarily by vomiting. So that is your key right there. Oh, the difference between these other remedies and ipecac is that you vomit and you do not feel better. Does anybody need this handout? And by the way, I said this before some of you came in. I sent out the wrong handout yesterday, so I have a proper handout with me today if you didn't bring the new one. So the new one should look like this. Does everybody have
one? That one you sent today.
Right? I sent it today. Okay. The one I think I sent it yesterday, the wrong one. Okay, good. So if you need it, it's there. Okay. So despite the nausea, the tongue appears clean and red, as opposed to being all coated with white or fuzzy looking or yellow or anything. Nothing gives the slightest relief, and there could be any bleeding that happens. Could be a nosebleed, it could be vomiting with some blood in it, but any bleeding would again indicate Ipecac as your remedy. An aversion to food. Makes sense. Then we have veratrum. So this is not only nausea, but severe, often projectile vomiting. As if you've been to any of my classes before, you know veratrum also has simultaneous vomiting and diarrhea. Vomiting accompanied by a cold perspiration. You know, you can see people are often kind of clammy, and you know, it's not a good state, especially on the forehead with chills. I want to tell you a really nice little story, which is that one of my students that came to my class, I think 2 months ago, we talked about children's remedies, and then her son got really sick with simultaneous vomiting and diarrhea, and he was sick for days, and at first there was just vomiting, then it was diarrhea, then it was both, then he'd have days where he was okay, but he wasn't eating, and he wasn't drinking, and anytime he ate anything, this would begin again. No energy. She called me on about day 4, and she said, I'm not sure what to do. I have given arsenicum album, which would be the first thing that came to my mind for that, but it seemed to make him worse because he immediately threw up when he took the remedy, but then he went to sleep. So then she's calling me the next morning, kind of before we could know too much. And I said to her, you know what, I think what you did was the right thing. I think he needs arsenicum album, and why don't you just continue with that? And this was a really, she was in a bad way. Like, I thought he might need to go get IV fluids or something in a day or so. This is not good, not being able to eat or drink for 5 days. So I was in my month of traveling, so I'm in the airport texting her what I think she should do. And then I get to my destination. I texted her the next day, how's it going? She said, oh, I gave him 3 doses of arsenicum and he came back immediately, 100% perfectly fine. I didn't even have to give the remedy any more times because I had told you can give it, you know, 3 times a day for a few days if needed. But I said, of course, once he's well, you don't need to give it anymore. And I thought, this is amazing. This is a great success story that I want to share with you because this is what can happen. Like, I think she felt like, well, I'll try it. And then she was a little uncertain. She called me to check in. I said, hey, you did a great job. Keep going. And it all resolved. And you can always do that. You can always call me and say, I'm just not sure what to do. I think it's this remedy, but I don't know. Or, you know, and it's really something that just in time with experience, you can learn to do yourself. So I thought it was very cool. Okay, moving on to hemorrhoids. Now, this would be hemorrhoids for any reason, but again, we're talking here largely about hemorrhoids as a result of giving birth, right? So much pushing on those delicate tissues. And so there are 3 main remedies for hemorrhoids. The first is Aeschylus. So hemorrhoid pains causing or associated with lower back pain, with sharp shooting pains up the back. This is one of my favorites. Rectum feels full of small sticks. I'm just thinking about that. That is not a good feeling. With a gritty sensation on passing stool. Sometimes it's just sore, so this stick feeling must be a very particular feeling. I personally have not had it. So these would be external hemorrhoids. You can see them, and worse from standing and walking, you can see that would kind of not be good. Then we have Rustox, hemorrhoids worse lifting, right? Because you're going to be straining something. They're protruding after the stool as if everything would come out. So, and then the last would be Hamamelis, which is profusely bleeding hemorrhoids with soreness. So, and with a tense bursting feeling. So, you know, things are obviously take time to come back to normal, and Hamamelis is witch hazel. And you may know that witch hazel is what you would put on your cotton pads and put it right on your butt to help those hemorrhoids shrink. So hamamelis is just the homeopathic application. It's a homeopathic preparation of that very same plant, witch hazel. Okay, any questions from anyone at all? All right, so mastitis, another horrible thing to have. Nobody who's nursing wants to be taking antibiotics. It's so painful, it's terrible. So this is really wonderful. I've treated a lot of women for mastitis, and it's just, it's again, it's like the nausea, just like, oh, thank God. You know, no more pain. You can nurse. It's not, it's just so, it can be so swollen and hard and painful. So the first is bryonia. And if you've been to my classes before, you've heard me talk about bryonia. So bryonia is a very glandular remedy. So it has a lot of affinity for the glands. That could be the cervical lymph nodes. It's the breasts are a gland. It's a very good remedy for mumps even. So all these glands, it's a very glandular remedy. So the breasts feel stony, hard, and heavy. And it could just be one, of course. Stitching pains. Now what's stitching? I imagine like a needle, like a sewing machine, stitching. Feels the pain all the way through the breast. The breasts are hot and painful and hard, aggravated by any motion or jarring, which is the keynote of bryonia, which is worse from motion. So if you recall when our bryonia patient has the flu and they're facing the wall and don't want to talk and they don't want to move because any movement at all makes them feel terrible.
Can I just say something?
Yes.
So we use bryonia a lot and for mastitis, and if you women can look really sick, like they're septic, fevers and shaking chills, and like you said, it's like magic. You know, one or two doses of bryonia, and what really looks like a bacterial infection and very well might be just lifts.
You don't have to give them it's like it just clears out what was stuck.
Yeah.
Can just like a clogged pipe. Gets cleared out.
Exactly. I've seen
it with many. It's so great to have your clinical experience here talking about this too. Wants to be left alone, just like the flu patient. And bryonia has this slow onset. Belladonna, on the other hand, which I've talked about a lot, has a very rapid onset. So in belladonna, the breasts are going to feel heavy, hard, and red. This is, of course, it's mastitis, right? It's an infection in one of the milk ducts. Of course, it's going to be like that. But it's going to have throbbing and redness, which is this hallmark of belladonna, this redness. Red streaks radiate from the nipple. There's great tenderness, heat, and inflammation. And like all belladonna situations, aggravated by jarring. So like this weekend, I was walking along and I accidentally stepped in a hole. This would be really bad. You know, like, oh, you jar yourself and it's extremely painful. Same with, as we'll learn later, with a belladonna headache. Any jarring, like, oh, I took a misstep and it jars you. Aggravation from jarring is a big general symptom for belladonna. And a swift onset. So very different from that bryonia, like a slow burn. Belladonna can go from well to sick just like that. Lacconinum, which is a remedy made from dog's milk. Constant pain in breasts and nipples. The breasts feel full of hard lumps. The breast pain can alternate sides. So this is a keynote of lacconinum. You can have a lacconinum sore throat that alternates sides. So alternating sides is the key there. Aggravated from the least movement. Loss of milk while nursing without any known cause. Meaning loss of breast milk production. So the milk is scanty for no apparent reason. Like you're well hydrated, there's no reason for that. Because one of the things that's really good is to continue nursing, because that really helps that milk flow, helps the mastitis, even though it's very uncomfortable. Phytolacca is a huge mastitis remedy, also a very glandular remedy, great for throat issues, cervical, tonsils, all these glands. The breasts are hard and very sensitive. Guess what? They're always hard and sensitive in mastitis. Sudden onset, engorgement. Possible causes could be a blocked milk duct, exposure to damp or wind. It's accompanied by cracked nipples. The pain can radiate from the nipple to the entire body while you're nursing. So that is something that I would definitely look for if I was going to give phytolacca. Mastitis during pregnancy, which would be before you're actually even nursing, so you can't even get that milk out, but your breasts are already engorging. Milk is thick, it's scanty and unhealthy, dries up too soon. Breast is hard as a stone after weaning. So you could even give this after weaning to get through that period of time, the weaning period. Any questions about all that? I'm excited. We're going to have so much time for my chronic stuff. Okay. Scanty, yes.
It's a bit of a silly question, but I do have a friend who just gave birth.
Yes.
And she doesn't take homeopathy. So how do I explain to her that there's absolutely no risk for her child? Because she's going to tell me, well, if I take it, it's going to get my milk. And
yeah.
Do what, you know.
So homeopathy is safe for everyone. It's safe for babies. It's safe. And I know you're asking me, why is it safe? But I'll just say first that it is safe for immune-compromised people, babies, adults, people with any kind of illness. And it's safe because it's energetic. It is not a substance that acts directly on the body, like an antibiotic or an herb even, because herbs are plant matter. Homeopathy is energetic medicine derived, in some cases, from plant matter, in some cases, from minerals, and as we've seen, in some cases, from animal stuff like milk products, like the dog's milk that we talked about. You could also refer her to my website, which has a whole frequently asked questions page about how is it safe, why is it safe, all about homeopathy, just to get kind of a synopsis, if you like.
Thank you.
You're welcome. There are no stupid questions because I have to remember to have beginner's mind. You know, I've been doing this a long time and sometimes I make assumptions, but I want to make sure that if you have a question, even if it seems silly to you, or, you know, don't be embarrassed, because I really want to make sure, because if you have it, probably everybody is thinking about it. Like, you know, so I want to make sure that, you know, I'm here to educate you. Okay. So scanty breast milk. We've got four main remedies: phosphoric acid. The mental state would be apathetic, indifferent, listless, and dullness. Phosphoric acid is a tremendously depleted state, so they could be depleted from nursing, and then the breast milk runs out, and there's just exhaustion. All the acid remedies are very depleted. Answers reluctantly and slowly, or short and incorrectly. Aversion to talking, wants to be left alone, cares about nothing, because they're just totally resources at zero. Agnus castus is a very specific remedy for breast milk. Breast milk is absent, a scanty, which means not very much, or entirely suppressed. The mental state is great anxiety or despair about health, despondent and anxious, mainly about her health, dullness of mind, and weak memory. You can see that these are both remedies that have to do with a kind of loss of vitality or lack of a vital state due to who knows what. It could be loss of fluids during the pregnancy, during the birth. It could just be the exhaustion from that experience. It could be many things. Loss of fluids is a common reason. Causticum. This is a different state. Disappearance of milk from fatigue, night watching, or anxiety. Causticum is a very anxious, watchful kind of state. And so if you have a sick child, or you have another child who's sick, not the baby, but another child, or your husband, or your mother, or your father, or someone that you're caring for, night watching is when you stay up all night making sure they're okay. And I know that we've all been there. Your child is sick and, you know, you're lying in their room and you kind of sleep for a few minutes, then you wake up and make sure they're still breathing, and, you know, you should get the stethoscope and you listen to them breathing, and or whatever it is you do. And that's night watching. And it can cause a lot of, you know, we can stand one night of it, but when it goes on for weeks and weeks and even longer, it's extremely depleting and debilitating. So this can cause, of course, it's a kind of stress, right? Which has physiological repercussions in the body, one of which is that you can lose your breast milk. Nipples are sore, cracked, surrounded with herpes. You don't have to have all of these symptoms, by the way. It's just that we're naming the main ones. A sticking pain, how is that different from a stitching pain? I don't know, that seems kind of similar to be stitching and sticking. Below left breast, dysmenorrhea means painful periods. Violent itching about the breasts in nursing women. The mental state is guilty. Night watching, nursing loved ones, keeping late hours and missing sleep from taking care of someone. Oversympathetic. This is a person who would be putting too much energy into that and not being balanced and taking time to care for themselves. And it is our tendency to just put everything into caring for our children, but we have to remember that, you know, like, put on your life vest first, because, you know, the baby might float with the life vest, but if you drown, then that'll be it, right? So you gotta, like, care for yourselves. Okay, urtica urens is a remedy made from stinging nettle, which is why here we have stinging nettle is used herbally to increase milk production. You can make a tea out of it. You can both pick it yourself in nature and make a tea, which I've done. It's also great for allergies. But you can also buy it from traditional medicinals. They make a stinging nettle tea. And it's very good for milk production as well as allergies. But as a homeopathic remedy, you'd be looking at just diminished secretion of milk after childbirth, especially with stinging pains. Because stinging nettle, of course, causes stinging pains if you touch it. So if you are going to go out and collect it, please wear gloves, because it's extremely painful. And it also treats other things like skin rashes and stuff like that, hives, things that you can imagine you would get from touching stinging nettle. I also put on here a link to Dr. Jay Gordon, who is a pediatrician in LA, a holistic pediatrician who has milk production suggestions on his website. All right.
Alexis?
Yes.
In regard to the tea for allergies?
Yes.
Right now?
Yes. It's a great time for that.
My son.
Yes.
That would be okay for him just to drink
it? Would.
It.
So I'm going to repeat the question just because we have all these recording devices going. So is stinging nettle tea okay for your son, who is how old? 10 years old? Absolutely. Yeah. I've given my kids stinging nettle tea a lot. I don't see any reason why you couldn't give it to a child of any age. It's not very tasty,
right?
So that would be the one problem. You can put stevia in it or honey in it. When I give it to my kids, I put honey in it.
Would the actual remedy work for him as well?
You know, when I think of urtica urens, the remedy, I think of it more for a skin eruption.
Okay.
Not hay fever. There are loads of remedies for hay fever in your books. And I have a whole lecture about that too. Lots and lots. Urtica urens wouldn't be my first one that I would think of. But if you just want to take a few things to, you know, while you're researching that and figuring out which remedy might be right while you look in the books, get some stinging nettle tea, vitamin C, quercetin. There's even a product, I'm sure it's here, called Aller C, which actually combines all of these things, quercetin, vitamin C, and something else that's going out of my mind right now. But those things are great for allergies. Yeah, and you can start with that. Those are just totally natural herbal things that you can do.
And nettles tincture works very well too. We have by Wise Women, nettles and ambrosia.
And you would just take it for your allergies? Just,
and it works particularly well on the eyes for some reason.
You don't put it in your eye.
No.
Just clarify.
And it seems to work for that.
Okay, so stinging nettle tincture as well. Similar. I think it's like the tea, but really concentrated. So that actually might be easier to give your kids than, because you got to drink a lot of it. And there they are, sipping the tea. Someone has a question.
Someone does.
Hi.
I don't know how to say their first name. It's Jamina Beal.
Oh, hi.
And
she's a pediatric alternatives patient who couldn't make it because
she
has a baby.
Hi there. I'm watching the class and I have a question about milk production.
Okay. Right. What's your question? Jen's going to, as you type it, Jen's going to read it.
Should I wait till she comes back?
We'll wait. Type your question and we'll get to it. I promise. Someone else had a question.
I had a quick question. Phosphoric acid, that's not the same as phosphorus.
It's not the same.
Okay.
No, different remedy. Phosphorus, phosphoric acid.
I just wanted to say urtica urens and another one work really well on this allergy that you get here. Is it white oak or red oak?
Poison oak.
My husband is really allergic to that. He inflicts everywhere. And I give him that immediately, the first sign, and it just goes.
What? The urtica urens?
And then there's another
the remedy.
Alium
sepa?
Yeah.
For the poison oak?
Yeah.
Okay.
Really?
See?
Yeah.
And
immediately.
The teacher becomes the student.
Oh, yeah.
So apparently, Allium sepa and urtica urens work well for poison oak, which is my nemesis. So I'm glad to know about that because I hate poison oak with a passion. Yeah, my family gets a lot of poison oak too. Yes. Okay. So our question is:
says I have oversupply of black ducks, but it's not mastitis yet.
Okay, got it. So I would say if you have blocked ducts, let's go back to the mastitis page. And I would say you would want to look at your symptoms. What if the blocked duct is causing what? Hardness, stoniness, a feeling of heaviness. Then you would pick a remedy, and I can send you this. You have this, I think. So
she says endorsements come and go.
Engorgements.
Okay.
I bet that's what that is.
Okay.
So then I would pick bryonia or phytolacca and start with that. It can be a blocked duct with a lot of swelling and induration, which just means hardness, even though there's no infection. So I would try that. And then if that's not successful, then you can call me. Okay. Thank you very much for asking your question. Okay, so let's talk about bladder infection. Oh, you have a question.
I do. So it's about milk production. So I am nursing. My baby is almost 5 weeks now, and I don't think my milk supply has come. I'm there yet. So it just got her to get a little weight, and this week I'm very happy, but still, like, she's nursing from both breasts and not satisfied. And
got it. So you have milk, but you're just feeling like it's too scanty.
Yes.
It's not enough. Got
it. Even pumping is like I got from my two breasts, not even 2 ounces.
Okay.
After like not feeding for almost 3 hours.
Okay, got it. Wow.
Yeah.
All right. So then we're going back to these remedies here, where the idea here, and I didn't start out this lecture talking about how we use homeopathy. I just launched right into the remedies because I have a video on the intro to homeopathy. I want you to watch that because it will help you understand that you need to take your own case, figure out all your symptoms, and then find the remedy that matches you, and you take that remedy and it's going to help. But I can't tell you what it is right now. You need to take your case. And I'm going to show you the book that you need. So there's this book by Miranda Castro. She's a really well-known homeopath, especially for children's care. It's called Homeopathy for Pregnancy, Birth, and Your Baby's First Year. It's going to be full of remedies for the issues that you're facing right now, including the breast milk. So the first thing that I would do is watch the video. The first thing I would do is go out and buy some tea that says for mother's milk, right? And make sure that you're really well hydrated. Then you want to get a book and you want to watch the video so that you know how to use homeopathy. And then you don't even need to go out and buy a kit because none of these remedies are going to be in the kit. Then you'll go out and get the remedy that matches the best. And what you're going to want to do is take that remedy every single day. If you're having an issue with breast milk, I would say take the book. I would say take the remedy every day. Now, I don't often say that. In fact, if you watch my videos, I will say, oh, you know, someone has the flu, give a remedy 3 times a day until they're better, which is usually a couple days later, 2, 3, 4 days at the most. But when you have an ongoing issue, you really want to support your body, give it support every single day to get itself going, like a big diesel engine that you've got to get it pumped up every single day, no pun intended there. So I would get a low potency, like a 12C, a 30C would be okay too, but a 12C, write that down, and take it daily. So that's the difference between this kind of situation. If you have a broken bone, you're going to need to take a remedy every single day for maybe a few weeks. If you have a really bad tendonitis, you need to take a remedy every single day because these tissues take time to heal. And with the breast milk, it's not going to just be like, oh, look, now it's perfectly fine the next day. You want to get your body revved up and going. Okay, it's a machine, it's ready to do it, it just needs a little bit of support. So I'd say at least a week you want to take it every single day. And you might even take it longer than that. Once your breast milk gets going, keep it going. Okay, and if you have any other questions, you can always call me and we could talk further about it. But I think first you need to watch the video and get the book.
And the video is on your website?
The video is on the Pediatric Alternatives website.
Oh,
it's on, it's not on my website yet, but it is on my Facebook page. And you'd want to look up the intro to homeopathy. I have a couple of different videos where I go over all those details about the philosophy of homeopathy. Okay, great. So bladder infections, another perfectly awful thing that happens. I don't know about you, but I'm telling you. I went through a period of my time where I had bladder infections a lot. Absolutely horrible. So I have some naturopathic care, stinging nettle tea, once again. Cranberry capsules and vitamin C are very effective. You should go to the doctor if you, cystitis is just a fancy word for bladder infection, if you have lower back pain because your kidneys are here, and if your bladder infection starts to go to your kidneys, you really want to go to the doctor. So, and what you experience that as lower back pain. So. But if no lower back pain, then you can treat yourself. The first remedy we'll talk about is Nux Vomica, which has the quality of urgency to go, but a feeling like you are not successful. Like you try and pee, but it doesn't all come out, and it has a feeling of incompleteness. The main symptom is this constant urging and a sensation of the bladder being full, that only unsatisfying small amounts of urine come out, and it just doesn't feel like it was done. Irritability, restlessness, usual Nux Vomica symptoms. Think of it when urging is the main symptom. So each one of these remedies has kind of its main symptom that we'll talk about. Yeah?
Tell a Nux Vomica story.
Please tell a Nux Vomica story.
So this is an example of how diseases are very emotional, or, you know, disease is an energetic state. So I was in a very stressful meeting with my ex-husband and my son. And I felt, other than stressed, I felt fine. And as I was sitting there, I started feeling like, I'm getting a bladder infection. This is so weird. I am getting a bladder infection. And we're talking about him going away to school, and it was okay, and I was in serious pain. So I said, excuse me. So I went to sit on the toilet, and I was new to homeopathy. I was still in school, and I had this sensation of need to bear down, and I didn't know what the remedy was, but I thought, okay. So I'm sitting on the toilet with my
oh, haven't we all been there?
Letters. It said, need to bear down, and it was Nux Vomica. So I've got my kit, and I took one dose of Nux 30C, and I swear, it just lifted and went poof, and I didn't need another remedy, and I didn't need antibiotics, but it was clearly the symptoms of a bladder infection. So that was like, oh my goodness.
It is amazing, isn't it?
I didn't quite even believe that homeopathy would work.
I know.
But it was one of those.
Sometimes I don't even believe it works, and then it works. It's incredible.
Yeah.
And And it doesn't have to even be a bladder infection. It can just feel like a bladder infection. I know I've said it so many times, but we don't care about the name of the illness. We care about the symptoms that are happening to you right now. And we don't, like, we can name it, but it really doesn't give us much information. But if it feels like a bladder infection, and okay, I'm going to leave that right there. Then it quacks like a bladder infection. Then you take Nux Vomica or one of these other ones. So here's another one. Petrosalinum, which is a remedy made from parsley, has a sudden intense urging to urinate, leaping up suddenly like, I've got to go right this second. Like there isn't this full feeling. It's like, oh my God, I got to go right now. An intense pain with itching and tingling deep in the urethra, desire to jam something up there to stop it. Think of it when itching or irritation in the urethra is the main symptom. Pulsatilla, our old friend. Pain with the urge to urinate. Sudden strong urge to urinate, but no capacity to hold it in. Pain increases with postponing urination, and then pain after urination. Urging to urinate begins even after one drop has collected in the bladder. So you've just gone and boop, one more drop comes and then you got to go again. I've so been there. Think of it when the pain is irregular or paroxysmal. Paroxysmal means coming on over and over and over. Like paroxysmal vomiting would be like vomiting over and over. So the pain is just comes again and again and again. Sarsaparilla. It's like root beer. Sarsaparilla. Pain at the end of urinating. I think sarsaparilla is good for about 80% of bladder infections. It's in the kit. It's a fantastic remedy for bladder infections and covers so many of them. So copious urination, as opposed to that little dribs and drabs from Nux Vomica, with burning pain at the end. Right? So pulsatilla is before, also at the end, but this pain before. Sarsaparilla, pain at the end with the last few drops of urine. The worst pain is at the end. Sometimes there can be blood, even crying out at the end because it's so painful. Think of it when this, yeah, I know, it's terrible. I know, but now you know and you can help your friends. I'm sorry. Do you know, when I was in school, my teacher had us each act out one of these remedies. I think it was like her little joke. Like she thought this would be fun for me to watch them do like petrosalina leaping up to go to the bathroom. So unfortunately, the result of that is that every time I talk about these remedies, I have the urge to act them out. So I'm sorry for that. Staphysagria. This is a fantastic remedy, has so many uses. I give it all the time chronically. And it's for a person who's getting cystitis, bladder infection, every time they have sex. So in the homeopathic texts, of course, women never had sex before they got married. So it's called the remedy for cystitis in newly married women because they're having sex for the first time. But this is like, you know, you get a little bit of bacteria that backs up into the urethra and every time you have sex, and then they end up with a bladder infection. So this is like repeated chronic bladder infections. By the way, you can cure that problem by urinating after you have sex. So good tip. Burning pain, pressure as if the bladder did not empty after urinating, as if a drop of urine is dripping in the urethra. And you think of it if you get it every time after you have sex. Finally, the worst of all, cantharis. So you've heard me talk about cantharis, the burn remedy, a remedy for burns as well as for bladder infections. It's the remedy that I gave to my son when he got a second degree burn when the light bulb landed on his neck, if you've heard me tell that story. Extreme intense burning pain during urination. Each drop feels like scalding acid. So this is going to be your most painful remedy. Shrieking from pain during urination. Feeling of, if I could just empty my bladder, I would get relief. Voluptuous itching. So it sort of crosses the line where pain has become like itching, and you think like maybe if I scratch or rub, it'll make the pain stop. It's like a very hyped up, desperate kind of state. If you remember me talking about cantharis before, this is made from Spanish fly. And so Spanish fly gives you this, it's an extreme irritant to the skin, to the bladder, to any mucous membrane. So it's incredibly painful. So that's why what we have here is it says, may even desire to rub the genitals or have sex. That's like a way of rubbing it to think that it will relieve the pain. Blood in the urine, better from cold applications. Think of it when pain is the primary symptom. This is really extreme pain. Any questions about that? By the way, that's the one I had to act out. So I tried to resist from acting that out too much for you. Okay, so now we're on to the role of homeopathy in chronic cases. So, and of course, if you suddenly remember something that you want to ask me about the acute stuff, feel free to do so. I just want to point out my books that I brought here. A lot of them are about thyroid health. The immune system recovery plan is about autoimmunity. This is about stressing less, meditation more, stress less. This is hidden. The hormone cure is really more about all different kinds of women's hormones, adrenal, estrogen, testosterone, thyroid hormone, of course. So this is a whole new set of books that I've brought with me here because I think understanding how your body works and what's going on with it is the way to live a happy, longer life, to feel well, to feel vital, to feel balanced. So that's what I want to inspire for you today, is talking about some of the things that face women chronically, and homeopathy's role in that is to help restore balance and vitality for really long-term wellness. It's not a band-aid to say, like, here's some medicine to make you feel better for now or something like that, which isn't to say I have plenty of patients who take thyroid hormone and I'm not opposed to that. That's perfectly fine. People take hormone replacement therapy. I can work with all of that, and sometimes then the need for those things becomes less or gone over time with the right remedies. And I do also have a lot of patients who come who say, I don't want to take any medication at all. I have Hashimoto's. I don't want to take any medication at all. So then, you know, I work with that as well. So I've chosen, and like I said in the beginning, this is care that I want you to get from someone else. I don't want you to care for yourself in this way. I want you to think about it, let it flow over you, say, oh my gosh, that sounds just like me, or oh my gosh, that sounds just like my sister-in-law, or whatever the case may be. And then you say to your sister-in-law, here, you need to learn about this. I want you to just let it flow over you and see and be inspired. I think self-knowledge, education, taking a proactive role in your healthcare is really important. Okay, so the things that we're going to talk about, based on what I have seen in my practice as major issues facing women, are migraines, thyroid dysfunction, perimenopause, and menstrual dysfunction. Okay, so let's start with migraines. So migraines are one of the leading serious health problems facing women. Of the 30 to 40 million people who have migraines, 75% of them are women. Yes.
Both of our printers might have had an issue here.
Yeah.
Oh, did you print the wrong one?
Well, I think missing a page.
Yeah, mine is like
that too. Oh, yours too?
Yeah.
Is everybody missing it? Here, we'll just pass them around. You might not be missing a page because I didn't write any of this in my handout.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
so
this is the part where I wrote notes.
I have my glasses on.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay.
I would lend you mine, but then I couldn't read. No, so none of this is in the handout.
Gotcha.
You can just take notes. There's a page on thyroid
yeah.
references, resources, and so forth. and then a space for you to take notes. Okay. So we'll talk about my, because you don't need to write down that 75% of 30 million people, which is 22.5 million people, according to my math major son, Dylan, are women. So many women find that their migraines are associated with their menstrual cycles, and in fact, girls are most likely to experience a migraine for the first time when they get their period. So it's really a major problem. So